I really feel delighted to be here since yesterday. So many things, but with one single clear objective, that how to make India better, how to make this world better. And the two main drivers which I liked very much, which are going to be the makers, as you said. One is the youth, young people. Lot of energy in youth, lot of innovation, lot of new ideas, lot of leadership, which I have been experiencing since yesterday among young people from Hubli as well as from many other parts of India. And the second very interesting and important thing, that how you are linking education, knowledge, little bit technology, entrepreneurship with the farmers, with the agriculture workers here in this part, which is very, very important in a country like India, which is highly based on agro businesses and production and agriculture and so on. So very, very inspiring. Having said that, let me begin with what Jayashree ji has done this morning with Ganesh Vandana. And the young boys and girls who started up with a question mark. The two things are very significant in this development dialogue. When we talk of Ganesha, it's very special. Because India had many gods and goddesses, the goddess of wealth, goddess of wisdom, goddess of vigor and power. So are the gods, god of creation, etc. But perhaps Ganesh is the only god. First of all, name Ganesha is very, very interesting. Gan does not mean the two combination of two words, Gan and Ish. Gan is not subject. Gan is not praja. Gan is the people. We, people. Gan. And the person who is the representative of people is Ganesha. The literal meaning of these two Sanskrit words of Gan and Ish is, he is the leader, he is the savior, he is the protector of people. And that gives a sense of democratic governance, democratic life, democratic societies. That is Ganesh, the very simple, clear, literal meaning of Ganesh. Send us to a deep value of democracy. And Ganesh is also a god of two important things. What, wisdom, we pray Ganesh, because he is the lord of wisdom and knowledge. And Ganesh is also the lord of prosperity. So great combination of a lot of getting obstacles, getting rid of obstacles, ensuring prosperity and wisdom. That is Ganesh. And that is something which is needed in our society. When we are talking of development, we have to think of democratization of development. Today, actually, I am talking, or my dialogue with you would be revolving around two things. One is globalization of compassion. And second is democratization of development. And for both, the pivotal point are the children. And the second gesture was also quite symbolic, the question mark. Most of us begin our journey with full stops, not with the question marks. Our conventional wisdom, our preaching, our teaching puts a full stop in our mind that this is the answer of everything. So we begin with the answers. We don't begin with the questions. That's why we begin with beliefs, bias, and so on. Why we believe in caste system? If I question why caste system is there, no rational answer. But it goes on and on because we are born in a particular caste. So we begin with the answer which was laid down by some people for some reasons thousands of years ago, and we carry it on. So many other things. And sometimes I see that it's not only some of those orthodox thinking, but also the conventional thinking which is prescribed by science, technology, also makes us to start with our life with answers, not with the questions. So in society, in religious life, in our so-called scientific life, we don't question, so we don't innovate. We don't want to get into a new research which can question the society, which can question science, which can question technologies, which can question religions. We try to avoid questions. So today, when we think of problem solving, it begins with the question and then we have to find answers. As they try to find answer within the question, when they put some candle fire, and because of the heat, then the question starts illuminating the whole green question. And the answers are coming at light. Friends, today when I woke up a little late. Sorry, Deshpandeji. You wanted me to get early so that, but I was in time. Narayan Murthyji was waiting, Krishji was waiting outside. Sorry about it. But your hospitality was so good and so comfortable. I got up at 8 o'clock and suddenly rushed as the boys were doing this morning and brush. And I was thinking. And then, of course, I ordered my breakfast in the room instead of getting down and meeting other friends. So, but when I read today's newspaper quickly on the front page, the very first story on the front page, perhaps in Deccan Herald, was about an incident which occurred here in Bangalore. An 8-year-old girl was taken away by someone. A man who kidnapped her or lured her away, raped her, and killed. The dead body was found yesterday. Some months ago, right, maybe a month ago, or less than that perhaps, there was a similar news that a 10-year-old girl, a daughter, was lured away by her father, raped, poisoned, and murdered. What kind of civilization we are living in? Today, when we are having this dialogue here in Hubli, what is happening with our children in the world? Yesterday when I was coming from Delhi, I was reading in Times of India perhaps, that this terrorist group, IS, is buying children and selling them. If some of those young children are not fit to become suicidal bombers, or the girls are not good to be sold as prostitutes or sex workers or just for their own sexual desires, then the young boys and girls are buried alive. In Yemen, some parts of Turkey, some parts of Syria and Iraq, 3,000, more than 3,000 young girls are kidnapped and held in hostage by this terrorist group. And all for sexual desires and selling for prostitution. This is a new business. And these people are claiming themselves as they are the saviors of religion and Allah and Islam. They are kidnapping girls for this purpose and all our daughters. Who are these girls? They are all our daughters. They are all our sisters. I was involved with a campaign to rescue the girls who have been made hostage by another terrorist group called Boko Haram in Nigeria. Almost 300 girls were taken from a school. Suddenly, the girls went to a school and they disappeared. 300 girls, almost. Some 80, 86 girls somehow fled, they ran away. And they told horrifying stories to the world. Horrible. Almost 200 girls are still living there in those conditions. The parents are writing to people like us. After winning the Nobel Peace Prize, I tell you, I feel more pressurized. I feel more morally responsible. When I was talking to the people in Pakistan, the day when my hometown, Vidisha, was celebrating a kind of homecoming after winning the prize, suddenly I got a message. A journalist called me, and she informed that almost 500 students have held hostage in a school by a terrorist group, and anything could happen. What is your reaction? I was shocked. I forgot to celebrate my homecoming. And my spontaneous reaction to them was that I make an earnest appeal to those kidnappers or those terrorists, Taliban or whatever. Please take me, make me hostage and release those children. Because they are my children, they are our children. Whether they are in Pakistan or India or in Afghanistan or in Iraq, in Americas, in Africa, whose children are they? But within an hour or two, I got another message that they started killing those children, one after other. I was talking to some of the mothers. One of them, you might have also heard or read, one of the mothers said that I have the only son. He was a little bit late this morning to go to school. I was angry with him. I dressed him up with new uniform and drinking water bottle. I sent him in uniform and received him in coffin. The whole body was bleeding, but the water bottle was still intact. The bullet did not pass through it. What kind of world we have made for our children? So many temples, so many gurus, so many priests, so many churches, mosques,
So many parliaments, so many businesses, so many NGOs, so many laws and constitutions. But we have to ask ourselves, are we not failing our children? Is it not our collective responsibility to take on our hats? I don't want to make you guilty or feel you guilty. But I wanted to just tell you that they are your children. They are our children.